I'm listening to Sports Talk Radio this morning, and they're talking about a fellow named David Clyde. David Clyde was a young man who was just a couple of years older than I am. He is now 57. He was born in Kansas City, and he was a left-handed pitcher who went to high school in Houston. And he finished 18-0 his senior year. And he was drafted by the Texas Rangers, who had just moved the team from Washington to Texas. And the owner of the Rangers was a fellow named Bob Short. And the team was struggling. The attendance was low. And they drafted this kid out of high school because he was a phenom. He was a left-handed pitcher. Whitey Herzog was manager, and Whitey Herzog wrote in his autobiography that he regretted going along with the owner, who would push him to leave this kid on the mound too long, and as a result the kid fried out. He burned out. He pitched way too much, and he was thrown in the major leagues straight out of high school. He's used as an illustration, I'm told, in baseball circles, because according to Wikipedia, Clyde himself is convinced that he was rushed too early in his career. And in 2003, he said this: "If nothing else came out of my career, the things I hear periodically are, we're not going to do what we did to that young man. We're not going to do to that young man what we did to David Clyde." Perfect illustration of somebody who gets an opportunity, but it's a bad opportunity. But keep in mind, this was all happening back in the 70s. In fact, this was in 1973 that he was signed by the Texas Rangers. And so you've got a young man who had potential, and it's that horrible story, it's that horrible phrase of what could have been. Well, what could have been versus what really was are two vastly different things for David Clyde. He could have had a long, prosperous career in the major leagues, but he didn't. He got signed by a scoundrel of an owner who had men working for him that wouldn't stand up to him and do what was right by this young man. And we can look at him and we can think, well, what was he to do? What was he to do? You go back in the 70s, and I was reminded as I was listening to this, I was reminded of those stories that I've read about the beginning of the National Hockey League's Players Association. Back in the day, there were the original six teams, and it's kind of reminiscent of what you hear in the early days of recording artists. You hear recording artists who just got absolutely scammed. Scoundrels, you know, who just absolutely hoodwinked them. And they got pennies for all the dollars that they were bringing in, because the business guys, the guys that knew the strings to pull, did the pulling of the strings. I mean, there are countless stories that we've heard about recording artists who got, well, we would say duped, but I don't know. Did they really get duped? We look at it today and may think that, but we look at David Clyde and we may think that, but it was the way the world was then. And I sometimes wonder, are there things today, are there things in the world today that it's just how it is? And one of the first things that came to my mind as I was listening to this story being told, and I'd heard this story before being here in Dallas-Fort Worth about David Clyde, you think about the young man who comes out of college and gets signed with an NFL team, but just gets on a bad team. Now, I'm a hockey guy, and today is Tuesday, June the 5th, 2012. I had to look at the calendar. And last night, the LA Kings won the third game They've won all three so far in the Stanley Cup Finals against the New Jersey Devils. And every year about this time during the Stanley Cup playoffs, those of us that are into hockey, we get reminded of some of the great players who have played the game, and they've never hoisted Lord Stanley's Cup. They've never been on a team that won the whole thing. It's such a ridiculously difficult thing to accomplish. And it's amazing when you start thinking about some of the great players who have played who just never got the opportunity because they were never on a winning team that won that much. Some who languished because they weren't part of a winning franchise that had a front office that was even committed to it. Good players do sometimes get signed and drafted by bad teams. It happens in every major sport. And you think, what are they supposed to do? You know, we all get amped up if some guy turns out to be a whiner, a complainer, wants to be traded. We're like, he's making millions of dollars. And I don't suppose that those of us that are not professional athletes, we probably don't really know what all that's like. Sometimes we do get ourselves in positions that are beyond our control. There's that. We do end up like David Clyde in that a team picks us or we get in a job situation. Today, I'm reminded of, there's a fella, I want to make sure I get his name right. Joel Manby is the CEO of Herschend Family Entertainment. And he has a new book out called Love Works. And last week, I think it may have been Friday, Andy Stanley does a leadership podcast that occasionally I listen to. And Andy Stanley did an interview with Joel about this book. And it's a business book entitled Love Works. Just today, Michael Hyatt on his blog did a review of the book. I'll put links to that over at the blog in the show notes. But in this interview with Andy Stanley, Joel was recounting how he had been the CEO of the North American operation for Saab automobiles. And he had had a particularly bad quarter, bad month, bad year, and got a call on Easter Sunday from the worldwide CEO. And just raked over the coals. Demanded he get on a plane, fly over that afternoon. He did. And when he got there, he was upbraided in front of all of his peers. And you can hear the pain in his voice. Go listen to that podcast. You can hear the pain in his voice as he's just telling the story. Here's a grown guy who's clearly got the capacity to be a CEO, or they wouldn't have put him in that position. And that's the way leadership believes they should respond. Here's the correlation. The Texas Rangers had a business that they needed to handle. They needed to get butts in the seats. And so we've got a young high school kid out of Houston. He can put butts in the seats. And so what if he's already pitched however many pitches is too many to pitch in a game? Leave him out there. Leave him out there. Well, the point of this gentleman's book, and I've not read it yet, but I've read enough reviews to get a sense of it, and I've listened to that interview, and I plan on reading it. Love as a verb when it comes to work, it does work. Compassion does work. Doing the right thing does work. And today I'm gonna kind of leave you with a couple of thoughts. One is, what do you do when it's you? What do you do when you are David Clyde? What do you do when you are Joel Manby and the boss is calling you on the carpet and it doesn't seem right, it doesn't seem fair? What do you do when you're the player who gets stuck on a bad team that has no commitment to win, but you desperately want to? What do you do? I think you do what Mr. Manby did. I think you get away. You get away. I don't know how long it took him. I don't know what the gap was between him being the CEO of Saab and then being the CEO of this Herschend Family Entertainment, where he is now. In fact, he tells a story on this podcast of having going through another difficult time business-wise. And one of the co-owners of this entertainment, it's a privately held entertainment complex that he is a CEO of, very family-oriented, faith-based, whatnot. He was just having a tough time, and he got a handwritten note from one of the owners. Now, at the time, according to the story, he was being wooed by someone else to become the CEO of their company, double the pay. Not only did the owner send him a handwritten note to encourage him, but the owner sent a note to the man's family, addressed it to his wife by name and his daughters by names, and basically thanked them for sharing husband and father with his company. He wasn't about to leave. Are you kidding me? He wasn't about to go take this CEO job, even if it did mean more money. That's the power. And he used that as an illustration, appropriately so. That's the power of love as a verb. That's the power of doing the right thing, as opposed to the European CEO of Saab worldwide, who believed, you know, I'm going to berate you in front of everybody. I'm going to rob you of your dignity. I'm going to show you no respect, and I'm going to show you who's boss. I think if you find yourself in those situations, I think you do whatever you can, as respectfully as you can, to get out of those situations and get yourself in a better situation. I think personal accountability and personal responsibility have got to reign supreme. I think you've got to take control over your life and your career. If you're in a bad situation, start today. Don't do anything rash, but start today to architect, how am I going to get out of this? How am I going to improve? How am I going to get myself in a better position? Oh, I know. People say, well, you just need to quit that life-sucking job and pursue your passion. Well, okay, that's not reasonable or real world for very many people. Better approach, do what you got to do to make a living, support your family, live your life, but be making plans, be taking some action, even if it's just a little bit of action every day to get closer and closer and closer to being able to walk out the door and to be entering into a new door, which is a far better situation for you. We can't get up every day, I don't think. It's a bad way to go. We can do it, obviously, but it's not a good way to go. We could get up every day and just absolutely dread everything. You know, life is just, it's awful. Don't do that. Get up today and face the fact that life today may be awful, but look at the brighter tomorrow that you're hoping to make of your life. Get out of a bad situation. Find something that you can fall in love with and start chasing that something. Don't drop everything today. Don't let go of everything today to go do that necessarily. Be smart about it. Be strategic about it. I think the second thing that I would leave you with is, now let's flip it and let's consider our role as the guy that did write the handwritten note, or as the CEO worldwide of Saab who did call the other guy on the carpet and behaved poorly. Or let's think about the owner of the Texas Rangers or the managers of the Texas Rangers who abused the poor high school pitcher. Let's don't be those people. Let's be people today who act with a degree of compassion. We can hold people accountable. We can hold people responsible. We can do the right thing, and we can be strong leaders, not only of our own careers and our own lives and our own families and our own careers and all that, but our own businesses as well. And we can still show respect. We can still do the right thing. No, it doesn't mean that you have to be soft all the time. It doesn't mean that you have to be, well, that's okay. You're doing a really bad job, but it's okay. I know you'll get better. No, I'm not saying that. But there's a way to do it and not rob people of their dignity. I learned a long time ago that one of the worst things that you can do is paint somebody in a corner and leave them there. So I'm going to leave you with this a little bit of advice. If you have people that you lead, and we all do, when there has to be some conflict, when there has to be some confrontation, it's fine, but have respect, have compassion. And as you paint them in the corner to make them aware of their own responsibility and your commitment to hold them accountable, because they are accountable, as you paint them into this corner where there's nowhere for them to hide, where they must come to grips with those things that they need to fix, all I ask is that you leave some path. It can be a narrow path, but you've got to, as you've painted the floor, and they're standing in a corner now where there is no paint on the floor, leave them a path so that they can get out of that corner. Because once you've said what must be said, end it by letting them up. End it by letting them out of the corner. End it by communicating to them the faith and the confidence that you have that they can do this, that they will do this. Food for thought. My name is Randy Cantrell. The website is BulaNetwork.com. This is the Yellow Studio.